Dennis Griffiths used to produce plays and so on at Hawkesbury, which still exists. And a new little group have taken over where everyone else left off. And we used to do little short plays, perhaps one-act plays. Most of the ones that he wrote were about Buckley, and hence the Buckley language crept in, really, you know. And he got talking about the Jubilee one day. He said, there's no need to tell him about the Jubilee, Howden. It's been a good many years since it started, so they can't tell us anything about it. Mind they, things have changed over the years. A lot of the children only go to Sunday school a couple of weeks before the big day, so they can get a ride on the lorry. We don't have any horses and carts anymore, and a fair amount of them probably don't know one half of the Bible stories. But there again, they'll never know. Any road, we'll have a go at one of the stories before we let them out to go warm, and we'll tell it like it should be told in Buckley. There was once a well-off farming sort of man, as had two lads. The young un was a bit of a flaxener, and one day he said to his father, "Father," he said, "I want what's coming to me, the knows me full share of what thou gonna leave, and like to have it now." Well, coming like that to the old man, it wetted him a dell. He nearly snuffed his dunnock. "Now some devil," he said to himself, "I can't change him, so I'll have to lump it." And he split his estate up between the two lads. Well, the young un, he soon tormed his share into brass and took his hook off to foreign parts. I can see him leaving the old man and the old worm as well. And he's not even waving goodbye to his father there, watching him and praying, "God bless thee, lad." As soon as he got to this foreign country, by gum, he let himself go, spending his brass right and left, squandering it on wine and fancy women and the like. And to make things worse, a big famine coming just then to that there country. And there the dokey Meggin was, were nought left except what he stood up in. And many a time he'd have been glad to fill his belly with pig food, scuffing and tormits and swill and the like. Then he come to himself a bit, see, and he said, "This time I've had me huckster. Here I am, clemmy to death, and there's me feather's servants back of one with more food than they're wanting for the mexing, and me here without a scorrick. I'll mug off back at one again. I'll say to me feather, 'Feather,' I'll say, 'I've sinned again God and again thee. I'm not fit to be called thee son no longer. Treat me like a servant, like one of thee deetlers.'" He was as good as his word. And the day come when he looked down from the little hill by the 5 acre and over the meadow he could see the old farmyard again. His old feather was coming out of the bottom shipping at the time, and he happened to be looking in the direction of the 5 acre, and he saw his lad. "Well, bless me soul and body," he said, "it's me lad coming warm again." His heart did a great big jump, and out as he was, he run out to meet him, lapped his arms around him and kissed him, and he said, "Hey lad, I'm glad thou's coming warm again." And the lad was as good as his word. "Feyther," he said, "I've sinned again God and again thee, and I'm not fit to be called thee son." But before he could finish that piece about his feyther treating him as if he was a deetler, the old man bawls out to one of the servants as had followed him, "Quick, fetch me fancy cloak, put me own Sunday best on him, put a ring on his finger and shoon on his feet, and fetch that fat calf and kill it, and let's have a proper do to celebrate the day. For this lad of mine was dead, and he's coming back to life again. He was lost, and now he's found." Now, while all this was happening, the other brother, he was a bit older than the one who's been coming back warm-like, well, he'd just finished his day's work on the farm. And as he was coming warm, he could hear the noise and the singing and the music and the dancing and all the randy-boo. One of the servants bossed into him all excited and shouted, "Quick, young master, come awarm. The brother's coming back again. And the feather's killed the fat calf for us to have a proper do." Well, that made the eldest brother as mad as a bull. "They go the way back, Sanders," he said to the servant. Why, he was Norry. He wouldn't go into the farmhouse, though. And the outfeather come out and exed him and exed him. "No, I'll not," he said. "Thee knows, feather, as I've sleed for thee, spring, summer, autumn and winter, all these years, and not once as thou give me as much as a kid for me to have a bit of a do and me butty meaties. But now this other lad's of thine's coming warm after spending all the hard-earned brass on wine and his fancy women and the like. Thou's even killed the fat calf for him." "Hey, lad," his good old feather said, "thou knows all I've gotten's thine. But this son of mine, the brother, was dead, and he's coming back alive again. He was lost, and he's been found. How can we help but celebrate?" Well, the tale ends there, but thou can read about it all again in the good old book.